your holy word. If I can't hear from you, I need more volume, then I'll know what to do. I won't go alone. I'll never go on my own. Just let your spirit guide. And let your word, everybody say it.
Speak to my heart, Lord. Give me your holy word. If I can't hear from you, then I'll know what to do. I won't go alone. I'll never go on my own. Just let your spirit guide. And let your word abide. Speak to my heart, Lord. Give me your holy.
Hallelujah. Welcome to the Potter's House Dayton International Ministries Worship on Wednesday. You tuned in at the right time. At the right time. We pray that on tonight that God hears us when we call out his name. We are truly excited about what God is about to do in this place. We are truly excited and anticipate God to move in this place. I don't know about you, but God, tonight, I need you to speak to my heart. God, tonight, I pray that you speak to somebody else's heart that's watching right now. Somebody needs a word from you. Somebody needs to feel you tonight, God. Speak, oh God. Speak, oh God. It's just one word that they need from you, oh God. Speak to them right now. Speak to their heart, oh God.
Speak to their heart.
Speak to your heart.
Oh.
Oh, yes, God. Yes, God. I need a word from you, God.
Hey.
Yeah. That's all it takes. That's all it takes. That's all it takes. It's just one word. The heart, the heart, the heart, the heart, the heart, the heart. Where your feelings from. The heart, the heart. Where we worship from. The heart where we live. God from. It's something about the heart. But tonight, God, our prayer is that you would speak, oh God. Speak to the hearts of your people in the name of Jesus. The word of God in Psalm 145 says, I will extol thee, my God, O King, and I will bless thy name forever and ever. Every day will I bless thee. I will praise thy name forever and ever. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. Father, tonight, your greatness, your greatness is unsearchable. We cannot find it anywhere. We looked high, we looked low, we looked to the left, looked to the right. Your greatness is unsearchable. Your love for us is unsearchable. Your mercy towards us is unsearchable. Your grace towards us is unsearchable. Tonight, oh God, speak to our hearts, oh God. Speak to us, oh God. We are waiting for you, oh God. Have your way, God. Tonight our prayer is that we please you tonight, oh God. Do, oh God, what it is that you would have us to do through us, oh God, tonight. But God, we pray that you would marry the word, the worship tonight, oh God, that it may be pleasing to you in the name of Jesus. God, everybody that's watching tonight, oh God, speak to them, oh God. Go to their situation. Go to their homes right now, oh God, and nurture them, oh God. And let them know that you're there and that you care. You know, you see, and you care, oh God. So tonight, God, we honor you. We bless you. We lift your name, oh high. Your greatness is unsearchable. We thank you in the name of Jesus. Every heart said amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Problems, some great and some small. You being God delivered me from them all. Still can't believe all the ways you made. Deliver me from them all.
Thank you. I shout your name. Let it be known you are the King of Kings. right where you are, just lift your hands. Right where you are, just begin to give him the fruit of your lips. Come on, change wherever you are into your altar of worship. Come on. Break open your alabaster box. Break it open your heart right now and pour out your oil of worship upon him. I guarantee it'll help you. It'll change your atmosphere. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You are, you are, you are. Oh, you are, you are, you are. Oh, you are, you are, you are. Oh,
you are, you are.
Come on, just tell him.
Kingdoms reign.
May your kingdoms reign.
of Judah. He's the Lion of Judah on the throne. When I call his name, he hears me. When I call his name, he hears me. When I call his name, he hears me. Call his name. Let it be known. Let it be, let it be, let it be known. Let it be known, let it be known. He's the King.
Yeah.
Of kings.
Hallelujah.
He's the King, King of kings. He is the King,
yes, yes.
King of kings.
Hallelujah.
The Prince of Peace.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yes.
May your kingdom reign.
Reign, reign, reign.
It reigns in my life. It reigns in my life.
Hallelujah.
It reigns in my life.
Hallelujah.
I know it will never, never cease. Oh, it won't cease. It won't cease. It won't cease. He's the Lion of Judah.
Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Bless the name of the Lord. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Giving honor to our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ, who is the Lion of Judah. We honor him tonight. We worship him tonight. We bless and glorify his holy and righteous name. One more time, will you put your hands together for Minister Pam and Elder Craig? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, for who you are. Hallelujah, you reign.
Yeah.
You reign supreme. We honor you tonight, sir. We bless you for the opportunity to be in your presence just one more time. Hallelujah. We give God glory. There is a word from the Lord tonight. And we're glad that you are here. And for those that are watching us over the airways tonight, welcome to our worship on Wednesday night service. We're glad you could join us. We're honored, amen, to be able to share the word of God tonight with you, God's people. Hallelujah. If you will, turn with me to Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. Luke chapter 5, verse 17 through 26. Hallelujah. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, Luke 5, 17 through 26. The word of God reads as follows. Those that are able to stand with us, as it is our custom, please stand with us at the reading of God's word. Hallelujah. And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. Luke 5, 17 through 26. And it came to pass on a certain day, as he was teaching, that there were Pharisees and doctors of the law sitting by, which had come out of every town of Galilee and Judea and Jerusalem. And the power of the Lord was present to heal them. And behold, men brought in a bed, a man which was taken with a palsy. And they sought means to bring him in and to lay him before him. And when they could not find
by what way they might bring him in because of the multitude. They went upon the housetop and let him down through the tilling with his couch into the midst before Jesus. And when he saw their faith, he said unto him, Man, thy sins are forgiven thee. The scribes and the Pharisees began to reason, saying, Who is this which speaketh blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God alone? But when Jesus perceived their thoughts, he answering said unto them, What reason ye in your hearts? Whether it is easy to say, Thy sins be forgiven thee, or to say, Rise up and walk. But that ye may know that the Son of Man hath power upon earth to forgive sins, he said unto the sick of the palsy, I say unto thee, Arise and take up thy couch and go into thy house. And immediately he rose up before them and took up that whereon he lay and departed to his own house, glorifying God. And they were all amazed, and they glorified God and were filled with fear, saying, We have seen strange things today. Hallelujah. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. We give God glory for the word of God tonight. My friends, just for a little while, I would like to speak with you on this subject. My destiny helper. My destiny helper. My destiny helper. Our prayer focus this morning was destiny helper. And the Spirit of the Lord has blessed us as the woman of God prayed this morning about Christ being our destiny helper and he calling us to be likewise. And so we're honored tonight to continue in that focus of sharing the word of God about being destiny helper for others. Let us pray. Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, we pray tonight. Seeking your face. Thanking you for your presence in this place. Speak to us now. The calming of our minds and longing of our hearts. By the words of my lips and in the thoughts that we form, speak, Lord. Servants are listening. Truly, Father, you are God and you're great, greatly to be praised. Pray for the people all around the world tonight. Many who long to see your face, yet do not know how to find you. May they see you in us, and in us where they see you, with the loving care that you've called us to show as death helpers. Father, we pray for those who are neglected, oppressed, those scorned, mocked, for those who are overlooked by the rest of the world, and they be convinced tonight they are precious in your sight, and may their needs be met according to the abundance of your grace. Father, we pray for our families and for our neighbors tonight, for all those who you have placed on our hearts, those who grieve, those who rejoice, those who struggle with conflict in their families, in their homes, and yet those who celebrate new birth new life, a refreshing. We pray for those who need work tonight, those who need a special healing in their bodies, their mind. Pray for those who are seeking a sense of peace to come over them. Rest there, we pray. We thank you, Father, for hearing our prayers, prayers of thanksgiving and intercession. So in this season, loving Father, we ask that you do not let our hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. Fill our lives in deeds of devotion and service. Help us to closely follow Jesus. He is the way, the truth, and our life. Joy and peace. Help us to know and understand that we are safe forever in the precious Holy Spirit, who is our destiny. Help us. He who instructs us and leads us all truth. And in the blessed and mighty and marvelous and wonderful name of Jesus the Christ, our Lord and our Savior, we pray tonight, have your way in our lives. Your will be done. We'll be honored, excited, thrilled. We give you all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory. Do your most holy and righteous name. We love you, sir. In Jesus' name. The people of God said amen, amen, and amen. Hallelujah. Bless the name of the Lord. Amen. So glad to see you tonight. As always, what a joy it is to be in the presence of an almighty God. A few weeks ago, we heard our bishop share with us after he preached a powerful message here at the Potter's House Dayton International Ministries, that even after 9, we're still here and we're going to be just fine. I don't know about you tonight, but here it is, almost a week and a half, 2 weeks since he had that prayer. How many of y'all doing just fine tonight? Glory to God. Amen. We're doing just fine. One of the things, amen, the bishop talked to us about as we jump into this word tonight. We talked about, amen, a going pro in this season. And we've talked about the importance of a prayer, being prayerful, walking in resilience, and walking in obedience. And just as a refresher and as a reminder, we're in this season, family, where we, as our bishop would say, we need to calm down. Amen. Amen. We need to have, amen, a prayer life that causes us to calm down, think straight, and move straight. In other words, walk in alignment to the will of the Lord. We're in this season where God is calling us to do the right thing. And let's do the thing right. We're in this season, amen, of resilience. A time and a place, amen, where we are trusting the Lord. A resilience, the ability, as my sister said in the message before, a week before, bounce back. The ability to bounce back from dysregulation and dysfunction. Amen. God is calling us, amen, to bounce back in Jesus' name. We bounce back to be more and better than before. Can you say amen? We're in this season, amen, of obedience. Amen. Becoming a living sacrifice. Paul called us, amen, to become a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. This is that season, family, amen, where God is calling us, amen, to be a living sacrifice, and I believe to be a destiny helper. Hallelujah. Here at the Potter's House, Dayton International Ministries, We've talked about it. We've seen it over the course of this last year in the midst of this pandemic, and our opportunities and abilities to serve our community, to be involved with social justice and meeting the felt needs of others. Amen. We're still doing ministry. Amen. Even if it's by virtual service, even if it's by, amen, doing a foundation class, amen, over the web, even if it's by doing a Wednesday night service, amen, through the Facebook Live, amen. However we can get the word out, however we can do the service of the Lord, somebody shout, we're still here. Come on, glory to God. Amen. We're still here. Serving Jesus, still praying, still praising, we're still here giving God the glory. Hallelujah. So we are the church, the ecclesia, not the building, amen, but we are the people of God making a difference in the lives of others. And the gates of hell shall not prevail. And for that, God will honor his remnant. And we remember, amen, that often it's the paradox of our faith that exalts him in our lives. Just when we've been hit with the enemy's best shout of tragedy, God has us set up for the best shout of triumph. Why don't you go ahead and give God a shout of triumph right here, amen. If you know, amen, the enemy has hit you with his best shot and you're still here giving God glory, giving God praise, you ought to go ahead and give God praise right there in your living room, right there where you're watching this message, amen. You ought to give God a shout of triumph. Hallelujah. God is good. Hallelujah. Psalms 46, 10 and 47 reminds us, I'm not going to read, I'm going to read 46:10 and 47:1. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth. Hallelujah. God is our refuge. He is our help. He's a very present help in time of trouble. Amen. And so the Bible reminds us in 46:10-11, he says, the Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Oh, clap your hands, all ye people. Shout unto God with the voice of triumph. Amen. And so that's what we do tonight as we prepare to continue to see God's hand moving in our lives and throughout this community and over this church. We continue to shout with the voice of triumph, amen, giving God glory for what he's done, what he's doing, and what he's yet going to do in and through our lives. Can you say amen? Tonight, my friends, we've read the scriptures, and we looked at, amen, this scripture in Luke about this young man who had some assistants who carried him, hallelujah, to Jesus. And prior to reading Luke 5, 17 to 26, we looked at Genesis 1 and 26, amen, where we saw what Jesus, where God said, let us make man in our image and after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and over the cattle and over all the earth and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. We read, amen, and we saw, amen, how God used Adam and Eve, amen, as destiny helpers for one another. Come on, Holy Ghost. He used Adam and Eve as destiny helpers for one another. And in this season, my friends, I just believe, amen, that we are in this season just as God did in Genesis, amen, when he said what he said about making a man in his image. What did God have in mind when he created the woman? Was she an afterthought? Was she the final word of completion in his beautiful, perfect world? As always, the best place to start is at the very beginning where God said, and we just read it, Genesis 1, 26 through 28. When you think about the scriptures, the Bible says in verse 28 that he said, God blessed them and God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth and subdue it and have dominion over all the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. Some examples, I believe, family of God, of destiny helpers. These are relationships that included, we just read a couple of them, Adam and Eve, David and Jonathan, Moses and Aaron, and many, many others throughout the Word of God, where God has used men and women to draw others to himself. Exodus 4, 15 and 17 says it this way. Talk to him and put the words in his mouth. I will be with both of you as you speak, and I will instruct you both in what to do. Aaron will be your spokesman to the people. He will be your mouthpiece, and you will stand in the place of God for him. Come on, Holy Ghost. Telling him what to say, and take your shepherd's staff with you and use it to perform the miraculous signs I have shown you. A destiny helper, my friend, is someone divinely connected to your destiny. He or she helps you to achieve what God has predestined you to be. Glory to God. Unfortunately, my friends, we're living in a world where many, even here in the church, many believers miss opportunities for elevation because they have preconceived view of what their destiny helper should look like. Come on, Holy Ghost. We are people who need people. Somebody say people need the Lord. And because we are human beings, people, God has built within us a rightful hunger for relationship, a longing for impact. Those needs for relationship and impact are built in and legitimate. It's only when we try to meet these needs ourselves without depending on God that we get ourselves into trouble. Here we are in the text, amen, this paralytic man, his friends showed remarkable determination to get him to Jesus. I like this story, amen, because they were determined that they were not going to let anything, amen, get in the way of them, amen, getting this brother, getting their friend, getting, he might have been an enemy. I don't know who he was to him, amen, but they were determined to get him before Jesus. Let me ask you a question, my friends. At what length will you go to get somebody else in the presence of an almighty God? What are you willing to sacrifice? How much time, amen, are you willing, amen, to sacrifice out of your time and your life to get somebody, your neighbor perhaps your brother or your sister, perhaps, amen, your friend, perhaps it's your enemy, glory to God. Are you willing to sacrifice yourself to get them before the Lord? The Bible says that this man, when you read this story, they tried to get the man into the house, amen, because they heard Jesus was there. And you know, everywhere Jesus went, he drew a crowd. And the Bible says that the house was so filled, amen, that when they tried to go through the front door, amen, they couldn't get in. You know how some religious folk are, amen, amen. You can't bring him up in here, amen. Ain't no room for that kind. You know, I can imagine some of the things that they heard, amen, from the people, amen, who were supposed to be religious folk. Come on, Holy Ghost. Jesus recognized, the Bible says, that the scriptures, Jesus recognized that an immobilized man needed help to come to him. Hallelujah. Here Jesus was moved by the friends of this man to forgive this man of his sin and to heal him. Many things, my friends, in life has the tendency to immobilize us from time to time. And I want to just share tonight that one of the main things that immobilizes people, especially those of us that are Christians, those of us who call on the name of the Lord, is believing wrongly about yourself will immobilize you. Come on, Holy Ghost. Thinking about yourself through your own lens opposed to seeing yourself through the Word of God. It has a way of immobilizing us, hallelujah, and keeping us stuck where we cannot allow or receive from the Lord what he wants to get us, amen, because instead of believing the word, we're believing the lies of the enemies. The result of living like this, my friends, the scripture clearly says to us, points out to us, that this is not the life that God wants us to live. As a matter of fact, it is a life, amen, of sin consciousness. God comes to give us freedom. The Bible says, whom the Son have set free is free indeed. But bondage lies in wrong thinking, wrong behavior. Bondage lies in wrong believing, of not seeing yourself as you really are in Christ Jesus. Wrong believing about yourselves, my friend, will immobilize you. Wrong believing about yourself, my friend, can cause conflict in your marriage. It'll cause conflict in your life. It'll cause conflict in your relationships. It'll cause conflict on your workplace. It will cause conflict in the areas of your life. And so God is calling us, amen, to eliminate from our thinking, wrong believing about ourselves, in spite of what the enemy says. We've got to trust what the word of God says about us. Can you say amen? Hallelujah. And so here in the scriptures, if you look with me to Romans 7:23, Paul says, I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. Hallelujah. This members here that they're talking about, my friends, it means your soul and your body, your flesh. It's not talking about your spirit. It says Satan has a way of getting his hooks, and he has a way, amen, of drawing us away from the presence of God, amen, and trying to confuse us, amen, by getting us or causing us to concentrate on the things of this flesh or on the things in our mind, amen, that's not rightly divided in the word of God. The enemy comes to confuse the people of God. He comes to keep us, amen, disoriented. He comes, amen, to keep us, amen, hallelujah, thinking about our circumstance opposed to thinking about our victories in Christ Jesus. He is the cause of the confusion. So I'm not talking about, amen, tonight of feeling confused, but what I'm talking about is the confusion that results from conflicts caused by wrong believing. Often, many of our brothers and sisters and friends and associates, they come to Christ only with the persistent encouragement of friends and family. We're talking about destiny helpers. When God chose, or when he chooses a destiny helper, as noted in Exodus 2, verse 11, through chapter 4, verse 20, Moses provides us a wonderful study of how God calls a destiny helper out of a crowd to perform an assignment. Number one, God gives the destiny helper an emotional investment in the work. Can you imagine, my friends, that these young men who carried this paralytic man before Jesus, amen, that they had to have some kind of investment in this man's life. They had to have some kind of investment toward him, that they were willing to do whatever they needed to do. I'm talking about even to the point of ripping off the roof of somebody else's house. Come on, Holy Ghost. I'm talking about tearing up somebody else's house to get their friend to Jesus. God gives the helper an emotional investment in the work or the assignment that God has called him to. Moses brought into the idea of freeing the Hebrews from bondage even before God called him to the task. Moses was invested in the work, in the assignment that he knew God had called him to. Number two, God affirms the helper through others. God will use people. When Moses told Jethro about his encounter at the burning bush, his father-in-law affirmed him. There are people who will affirm, amen, the call of God on your life. There are people who will affirm, amen, I've been praying that God send me somebody, amen, and here you are telling me about what thus said the Lord. I know that ain't nothing but the Holy Ghost. Come on, Holy Ghost. That ain't nothing but God. People will confirm, amen, that you are in the will of the Lord. God affirms. Number three, God gives destiny helpers mentors. God gives destiny helpers people who will walk alongside them, amen, to get the job done. Amen. One friend couldn't have done it by himself. He needed three other brothers, amen, who were in agreement with the will of the Lord, who was willing to come alongside him. That's why, my friends, we got to be oneness in this season. That's why, my friends, we got to walk together. We got to live together. We got to do this thing all together. Somebody said we're in this thing together. And we've got to move in the Spirit of the Lord together that God might perfect his will. God gives mentors to divine destiny helpers, amen, that we might get the task done. Moses asked for and received help from Jethro, Aaron, and others. He had other people who were significant, amen, in him completing the assignment that God had for his life. Number four. God builds on the destiny helper's strengths, experiences, and background. God uses everything in Moses' background to help him fulfill his calling. The fine education he received in Egypt, his knowledge of Pharaoh, his understanding of Egypt, and his time in the wilderness. God used it all, amen, to get the glory out of Moses' life. God will use everything about you to bring somebody else to Jesus Christ. And that's why, my friends, we've got to be strong witnesses for the Lord. That's why we can't be afraid, amen, to testify about the goodness of God. That's why we got to be transparent and be willing to share our story. You have no idea of what God will do and how he will use you. Amen. Somebody said he'll take my mess and make it a message for somebody else. Come on, Holy Ghost. God builds on the destiny helper's strengths, experiences, and background. Number five, God often refines the destiny helper's character in obscurity. You remember the story? Somebody said, David, come on, Holy Ghost. You remember Moses? He received a 40-year seminary education in the wilderness. Come on, Holy Ghost. He wandered in the desert for 40 long years. With a stiff-necked people, amen, who wasn't trying to hear nothing he had to say, amen. But it was the greatest education that he could ever have, amen. And guess what? He didn't abandon his assignment, amen. He stayed with the Lord. Come on, Holy Ghost. He stayed with the Lord. Hallelujah. So God refines the destiny of destiny helpers. God will refine us, amen. I don't know what's going on with my page. I don't know if that's you guys up there, but this thing getting blowed up. Hallelujah. And I'm trying to get it back down. I don't know what's going on with it, but amen. That's why we brought the paper, amen. The devil is a lie. Can't stop the Holy Ghost, amen. But God is good, amen. God is good. He's good all the time. And so here, Jesus will use a destiny helpers, amen, to do what God has called us to do. And so what is it that we're saying tonight? Hallelujah. The result of walking in Christ Jesus and allowing God to use our witness, to use our life, amen, God gets the glory and he will use us to bring others before his presence. My friends, I believe the word of the Lord is clear here, that a destiny helper is much more than just a helper. When we consider these four men carrying this paralytic man, the Bible reminds us in Luke 5, 18 and 20. Y'all got to follow me up there. I done got my computer and went haywire, so I'm going to my paper now, so I may be a little farther along than what we thought. As a matter of fact, I am. Let me go back real quick. I'm sorry. I apologize for that. Go back to number 6. Number 6, when God chooses a destiny helper. Let me complete that because I got a little ahead of myself. My computer is doing something else. Number 6, God instills in the destiny helper the value of hard work. When you're talking about being a destiny helper for somebody's life, amen, it's going to require a hard work. When you're talking about, amen, leading somebody to the Lord, and you're talking about being a witness and being a mentor to somebody, amen, you're going to have to endure hardness as a good soldier. You're going to have to deal with some things, amen. I can imagine, glory to God. We don't know, see, the Bible don't tell us how many times these friends went over to this man's house to try to get this man to come out of his house and get to Jesus. We don't know how long they had to beg him and plead with him. Man, if you want to be healed, all you got to do is let us get you to Jesus, amen. We don't know how long it took him, amen, but God is telling us tonight, amen, that to be a destiny helper is going to require, it's going to cause you, amen, to have a value of hard work ethics. You got to be willing to hang in there with folk, hallelujah, even though, amen, they're getting on your last nerve. You got to be willing to hang in there, amen, to get them to Jesus. So many times you know how we get, amen, we get frustrated with people. We be like, man, I've been dealing with this brother. I've been trying to get this sister for a long. I'm tired, amen. I keep telling them the same thing over and over. You know how we get sometimes. Moses may not have worked much in the Egyptian palace, but he learned its worth of work, of hard work in the desert. He learned the value of hard work in the wilderness. He learned the hard value of hard work trying to get people, amen, to Echo West, amen, to line up with the will of God. He learned the lesson, glory to God, a valuable lesson in the wilderness. Number 7, God sustains that helper with the powerful vision. Moses caught the vision of the promised land long before the Hebrew slaves did. Oftentimes, God will show you, amen, something about what he has planned for somebody else's life, and they may not have a clue, amen, what God is doing. But God will tell you, hang in there with them. Keep going in there with them. Stay at it with them. Keep praying for them. Keep believing me for them. Amen. They don't see it right now, but God allow you to see, amen, what they fail to see so you can help get them to where they need to be in Christ. God will sustain you with the powerful vision. Number 8, God brings others alongside you to compensate for their weaknesses. Hallelujah. God will bring others alongside you, amen, to help compensate, amen, for your weaknesses. And sometimes, my friends, that's why we need, amen, to surround ourselves with people, amen, who can be responsible and who can also help us stay accountable to the things of God. Because sometimes in leading folk, amen, if we're not careful, amen, instead of bringing them out, they'll bring us in. Come on, Holy Ghost. Moses enjoyed the help of Aaron as his spokesman, Joshua as his general, and Hur as his battle supporter. Moses surrounded himself with people who could help him get the job done. One of the things I've come to know as pastor as minister of the gospel of Christ, amen, I could never be who I'm supposed to be in Christ without the men and women of God like yourself that God has surrounded me with, amen. It takes all of us, glory to God, hallelujah, to get the assignment done. Yes, sir. Glory to God. Hear what the Lord is saying, I believe. That a destiny helper is indeed much more than a helper. In Luke 5, 18 and 20, this stood out to me, and I mean, it blessed my soul as God had prepared this message in my spirit today. And behold, men brought in a bed, a man which was taken with palsy. And they sought means to bring him in. In other words, they tried everything they knew to try and get him before Jesus. Even in the midst of ridicule, even in the midst of denial, even in the midst of trying to get him to turn around and go back, even in the midst of folk, amen, not willing to allow them into that space. They went through all kind of things. They had to endure all kind of affliction, and they had to endure all kind of ridicule, but they didn't allow these things to stop them. And the Bible says in verse 19, and when they could not find by what way they might bring him in, because of the multitude, they went upon the housetop and let him down through the tilling with his couch into the midst before Jesus. And watch this. The Bible says when Jesus saw their faith, he said unto the man, man, thy sins are forgiven thee. My friends, whose healing, whose deliverance, whose freedom are you holding up because you refuse to be used by the glory of God? The Bible says that he saw their faith to get this man before Jesus. God said he responded based on their faith. And he told the man that his sins were forgiven and God healed him. In short, my friends, a destiny helper is one who assists another in reaching complete fulfillment in Christ Jesus. Someone who assists another in reaching complete fulfillment in Christ Jesus. I don't see anything demeaning about that. What about you? So God is calling us, I believe, my friends, tonight. What does God see when he looks at your faith? Are you a destiny helper for others? Or are you a hindrance? Are you drawing other people to God through your faith? Or are you drawing them away from God because of your foolishness? A destiny helper. Someone who God used to assist another in reaching complete fulfillment in Christ. My friends, I submit to you tonight that we're talking about winning souls for Jesus. People are lost. People are hurting. People are wondering and looking for an answer. And I submit to the body of Christ tonight that the answer lies in Jesus Christ. What are we doing to win souls for Jesus? You told someone today about the gospel of Christ? Has your life modeled in an example of what it means to live for Christ? That someone might ask the question, what must I do to be saved? What does God see? He looks at your faith. Hallelujah. A destiny helper. We all have a responsibility and accountability to lead others to Jesus the Christ. Can you say amen? So, family, the only way they're going to come is through our persistence, our encouragement, and our loving them. Loving them into the presence of an Almighty God. Father, use us to be a destiny helper in the lives of others. Use us that others might come to know you, the fullness, pardon of their sin. They'll turn their lives over to you and allow you, Lord God, to reign supreme as the Lion Jew. Father, we love you, we thank you, and we give you all the praise for your word. Be glorified in our hearts is our prayer. Amen. God bless you, my friends. God bless you. Hallelujah. Amen. We bless the name of the Lord tonight. A destiny helper. God is calling on us. Amen. To do all that we can to get others before him. Amen. On our job. In the marketplace. Hallelujah. Within our families. That one we run from when they say he's coming over or she's coming over. You know how we hide? When I don't want. God says, no, you come on, Holy Ghost. Amen. Be a destiny helper. Amen. And get them before the Lord. Amen. Amen. God bless you and God keep you is our prayer. We love you and we thank God for you. Go back and read those scriptures. That Luke chapter 5. Powerful. Chapter. Look at how throughout scriptures how God used men and women as destiny helpers to get one another to help complete their assignments in him. God might use them for his glory. And he wants to do that with us. Amen. Amen. We bless God for you. We thank God for you. Amen. And for those of you, amen, that does not know, that maybe not know Christ, want to be saved and you want to be used as a destiny helper, want to help others get to know Christ and your family, you want to see family members saved and washed in the blood of the Lamb, amen, allow this word of God tonight to comfort your heart and cause you to move toward Jesus. Amen. Move toward Jesus the Christ. Hallelujah. That he might use you for his glory. Jesus' name. We invite you, amen, to also want to sow a seed love offering. If you want to sow a seed of support for the ministry of God, we invite you to send your love offerings, tithes, and your offerings to the Potter's House, TPHDIM number 2. TPHDIM the number 2, our Cash App. We look forward to hearing from you. Also, send us a note on our Facebook page or however you can contact us. Amen. Write us a letter. Let us know what God is doing in your life and how we might assist you. Amen. We want to be a destiny helper for you. Amen. In Jesus' name. We love you and we thank God for you. Until we're able to meet again, go in God, go in grace. Amen. And have faith in God. We love you. God bless you. God keep you.